Well, good evening, everybody. There we are. Today we are going to do a special all models to show you, because we are doing a mainspring special and there's more to it than you think. Regular viewers already know what's coming, but with the story about the mainspring, we do need this. We are going to talk about the mainspring. Almost by definition, yes, I'm aware of the spring drive. We're talking about mechanical watches. Because quartz or battery operated watches haven't got a mainspring. The mainspring, I'm not going to talk about the complete movement because most of you are already really into watchmaking. Just this very simple movement, ETA 6497, and here you can wind the watch. You can see already the balance wheel moving a bit, and I wind a bit more, a bit more, a bit more, and then you see the movement is self-starting. We are winding the mainspring and the watch is going to start running. And that's exactly the same as what we're doing here. We're winding the mainspring and it releases its power. Toy, when I'm winding the mainspring, I'm holding the back wheel with my finger. And when I release it, all the power is gone. Well, the same here with the click, in Dutch is the pal, and that is preventing from the mainspring release its power straight away. This small part, the power is maintained in the main barrel. The material of the mainspring, here you can see it's a rather big one, the nice shiny material of a big mainspring. This one, you can see it's so much darker than the modern mainspring. Don't look at the dimensions, just the color of the material, that's important now. This is carbon steel, the older ones. And the newer ones are an alloy. This alloy is far more superior over the darker carbon steel. It's more resilient, less prone to oxidation, and of course you can imagine carbon steel, the oxidation or rust is in there. And here you can see quite a difference in shape. This is the older one. Carbon steel with the normal curve, and this is the later one, but I'll be explaining this one a bit later on because we are talking about the evolution. Here is an excellent example of two mainsprings from the same material. As you can see, it's a darker carbon steel, and this spring is completely worn, and it's very small and it's got no resilience. All the, well, the force or power is gone. This one is new old stock, so it's a very old spring but never been used, and you can see the difference in tension, and this one is completely gone. So here you can see with old springs, this one is used and this one still got this power in it. But still, we're not very happy to use these springs because of the used material, the carbon steel. Here is a newer spring, and it's got a different shape. And the most important thing to remember is a watch is running accurately with a constant force on the gear train. Like the same with a clock, if there is a weight hanging on a huge clock, the weight is always the same. So there's a constant weight or a tension on the, of power, on the gear train. When you wind this mainspring, when you wind it, it's got a lot of force, and during the day the force is getting less, and here in 24 hours, 36 hours, the movement stops. So the power is less, and then it's over. That's why a power reserve doesn't stop on the zero, but a bit before that, because I'll show you later on. Stops being accurate. A movement needs a certain force just to be accurate, and after that isn't accurate anymore, and that's because of the amplitude. I'll do a later special on the balance wheel. With this spring, it's a bit like this. Because of this curve, here is a bit, it's got more power in the second half of the day. First half, second half. So on the same moment, the watch is so much more accurate. And that's because of the curve. This is. A bit like that. So it's longer, got a constant force, and it's more accurate. That's important. Now I can show you a watch like this. This is a very simple, cheap Chinese skeleton. But I use it to show on schools and for children. Look at this. Here's the mainspring in the barrel. And you can see it isn't wound. So all the spring is on the outside, and here the arbor on the inside, and it doesn't move. But it is an automatic winding. So instead of winding like this, it's got an automatic winding system, and it's with a rotor. You see, this weight is moving. So when the weight is moving, the watch is winding. Maybe you can see this curve getting smaller, and now I start winding. And here you can see, you see the difference in the shape of the mainspring is being pulled in, and it starts running. So when you wind it, the mainspring from the outside is being pulled inwards. More and more and more it's being pulled inside, and in a moment you'll be seeing no spring on the outside and all the winding is on the inside. The spring is being pulled inside. But when Wearing this watch all day, you keep on winding it. So what happens? With the automatic, the force of the mainspring is always constant because it's completely wound, because you wear it all day, whatever you're doing. So an automatic wound movement is not because you don't have to wind it, it's more accurate. That's the main purpose of an automatic wound movement. And that you don't have to wind it is a nice bonus. But the only reason an automatic winding movement is accuracy. Because there's always a constant force to the gear train. Now that's important. There is no use of making this curve into carbon steel, because the new later the alloy is so much more superior. So you don't want this. But in earlier times, they knew about the constant force and the accuracy, and they couldn't make this curve because it won't hold too long in carbon steel. So they had carbon steel with the downfall of losing the force. So in the, I think even early as the 1300s in clocks, but definitely in 1600s in watches, they came up with this. Well, this one has got a normal main barrel with, which is very high, so a heavy spring. I'll talk about the dimensions later on. But you see an incredibly small chain linked to this. It's from a pocket watch. Yeah, Munchie Crunch. So if you wind the watch, the chain will be on the smaller diameter. So even in the era of the carbon steel mainspring, it's called a snack. And snack is German for snacker, snail. And this is built like a snail. So when you wind it completely, it's on the smaller diameter. The mainspring got huge power. So it's got a lot of force. And at the end, relatively, with the larger diameter, it's still just about a constant force. So all this and the chain and the barrel were just made for accuracy 300 years ago. That's amazing, isn't it? And if you can see the detail of the spring, but here you can see, ah, Erik, dankjewel. These are riveted. You can see it's exactly the same as a bicycle chain. There is a small rivet. But just for accuracy. And that, I think that's amazing.